Good morning. Y'all seem to like each other still. It's a good thing. Well, good morning. My name is Jake. I'm one of the pastors here alongside Mike. And we're going to continue our series in the book of Mark. And so if you want to open up to Mark 6:45, you can do that right now. We've been going through this series called Just Jesus, looking at the person and the character and just our Savior Jesus Christ throughout the book of Mark. And we've been going through these mini-series. First, it was Come and See, and then this week, we're wrapping up our mini-series, All Authority, just looking at the authority that Jesus has over everything. And then next week, if you're going to be back here, we're going to get to kick off a new mini-series. You'll have to find out what it is, because Dave Stone will actually be here on Sunday, and we're looking forward to that. Yeah. So, we're in Mark 6:45. It finds Jesus and the disciples back in a boat, on the water, with a twist. And this isn't deja vu. Yes, you did. We were just in the boat, on the water, with Jesus and the disciples a couple weeks ago with Pastor Tommy out of Mark 4:35. And this is just a little bit different. This isn't deja vu. Completely different story. Completely different application. But besides remembering Tommy and what he was preaching out of there, I was just reminded a little bit of my own childhood and growing up. I was a little bit of a child of the water. I spent many summer days, like many of you, in Michigan. My grandparents owned a cottage on Spring Lake. I think we've got some pictures. The 90s are looking a little bit better today than they did about 5 years ago. So many, many potent memories from that time. My grandparents owned a boat. That's what I'm on right there. You can keep those up for just a second. It was called the Cat's Meow. It was a 21-foot-long Chris Craft with a 6-cylinder Chevy engine, my grandfather would tell me. I remember holding on to the bow of the boat, holding on. My brother Grant and I used to have to share a cleat because we both wanted to be at the very front. There were two cleats right at the front. We had to share because otherwise it would just be fighting the entire time. I remember the first time my grandfather let me put my hands on the wheel of the boat and steer it around and just the sense of just like power and awesomeness that was right there. Like, I've got it. Finally, my hands around it. And if you think that I'm young and you're looking at that date, like 98, goodness, he's so young. Just remember this. Babies born in 2000 are turning 20 this year. I feel old too. So when my grandparents sold the cottage, they asked all the grandchildren and their children what it was that they wanted from the cottage. And there were three things I really wanted. I wanted a map of Spring Lake that was the first thing you saw when you walked into the cottage. I wanted the wind chimes that were outside of the cottage because every time I hear the sound, still to this day, I'm like literally transported to that place. And then the third thing I wanted, I brought with me today. And it is this. This is a replica sailing boat, and it is tall enough that I can just put it right here on the ground, and you can all see it just fine. That's perfect. I love the water, and I really wish that I knew how to sail, but I don't. But I love this sailing replica. It was just like one of the things that was like one of the first things you saw when you walked into the cottage, and it just evoked such powerful memories for me, and I've sailed, I think, twice. Both boats are probably about the length that I am now tall. So they were little sailing boats when I was very young. But sailing has just been one of those things I have this weird obsession with. I watch hundreds of sailing videos on YouTube. I love watching it. I think my dream vacation would be to charter a catamaran and go to the Caribbean, learn how to sail, do spearfishing, and like, not sleep because you're learning how to sail in bad weather. That, to me, sounds unbelievable. My wife is like, great, just leave me on the beach. So despite owning a replica, despite watching sailing videos and this weird dream vacation, I know almost nothing about sailing. And for the disciples, despite spending time with Jesus, despite seeing miracle after miracle, wisdom beyond wisdom, healing after healing, the disciples were still blind to who Jesus is. And you and I are in the same danger of that myopic vision of who Jesus is. So let's start looking at this. Verse 45. Immediately he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had taken leave of them, he went up to the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out at the sea. He alone was on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he came to pass. He was walking on the sea. He meant to pass them by. But when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought he was a ghost, and they cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Heavenly Father, we come here today, gathered as believers, worshiping your name, calling out to you, and trying to see you for who you are. And so, Lord, I pray that as we look and see what is recorded in your word, that we might rightly see your Son for who he is and grow into it. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen. So the challenge is that we need to see Jesus for who he is. And the first thing that we see is this. He says, "I am sovereign over your storm." Two quick little observations. The disciples aren't necessarily asking for rescuing here. In the Mark 4 passage, they're in desperate need of saving. The waves are coming over the boat. They're holding on for dear life, and they're crying out like, "Jesus, why are you asleep?" And in this instance, they're not necessarily needing saving, but they're certainly not going a whole lot of places very quick. They're impeded by two different storms. We're going to get into that in just a second. The second observation is this. Jesus defeats the storm before ever setting a foot on the water, because before the storm hits, he's praying with the Father. Before the storm even happens, he's found himself in the presence of God the Father. And because of that prayer and that time with the Father, he's already defeated the storm. So here's the two storms that are battering the disciples. Two storms battering the disciples, and there's one solution. The first is the storm around me. So, curiosity question. I am not a sailor. Are there any sailors here in the room? Anyone? One. We got one sailor. So, for the rest of us, we need a quick lesson in maritime physics and geometry. If that's frightening you, don't worry. I have another illustration that will be much simpler. But for those of you interested like me, I want you to think about this. The storm around me. So finish the sentence for me. The shortest distance between two points is a straight line. The problem is that in sailing, if you have a headwind that is coming directly at you, sailing in a straight line is just not going to work. And so I'm going to pull this up. So for modern sailing, the way that they do this, it's called tacking. Let's just say that the wind's coming directly down the aisle right here. If they're going to sail directly into the wind, nothing's going to happen. This boat's going to go that way, because here's another sentence for you to finish. For every action, there's an equal and opposite. Fantastic. See, you guys, you're with me. Get the physics thing. We're together. So tacking. Instead of going directly into the wind, a modern sailing vessel will turn slightly against the wind and weave and zigzag back and forth. As the wind fills the sails here, it puts the physics now. We're putting pressure here in the water on the keel, and the boat is able to make progress by going back and forth and back and forth. But the problem is that ancient sailing vessels didn't necessarily, especially the fishing vessels in Galilee, didn't necessarily have this makeup and build. They were a flat hull. Can we see that picture of a small sailing vessel with a single square for a sail, really only used if the winds were in excellently favorable conditions. And so the only way to actually make progress when you have a headwind is to row. So you get four guys, and they'd just be pounding it out and just heave, oh, heave. And so if you look at the book of John that captures this same story, John says that they've been rowing for 3 to 4 hours. it would take 2 hours to walk the distance to where they were going. 3 to 4 hours. Making headway painfully doesn't cut it. They're barely going anywhere. So this is the storm around me. And if you're still just a little bit lost on this whole sailing thing, I have another illustration. This is a mountain pass. Have you ever tried, who's driven a car before? Okay, more drivers than we have sailors. That's a good thing. So if you're driving up a mountain, which ironically doesn't exist here in Illinois either, the way that you do it is by switchback over and over and over and over again. You're doubling, quadrupling, quintupling, septupling. You're making your distance so much more just to pass over this difficult stretch. The shortest distance is a straight line, but that's not possible. And so you have this storm around me, and it's as if the sentence is like, I keep going at the same problem, but my progress is pitiful. The market crashed. I lost my job. My husband made poor choices. Our debt is crippling. No college will accept my application. When these things start coming up against you and you feel like you're trying to make progress, but it would be a lot easier to just walk the distance. Storm around me is billowing up. Here's the second storm, the storm inside me. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them, and about the fourth watch of the night came to pass, walking on the sea. He meant to pass them by, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost and cried out. But they all saw him and were terrified. If the storm around me is, I keep going at the same problem, but my progress is pitiful. The storm inside me says, I'm stuck in this place, and I can't do anything to get out. So two of these things are coming at the disciples. They're trying to get through this storm. But they can't defeat the things that are coming against them. And internally, they're crippled. The whirlwind in my mind has absolutely paralyzed me. I did everything wrong. It's falling apart. These are two storms, I think, that we're pretty familiar with. Something that's outside me that I have no control over, but I have to work through. Something inside me that I have lost control of and is running away with my heart and my emotions. But Jesus says, take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid. It's funny, I think, because his divinity is on full display. He's walking on the water. But this is a very human thing to say. So here's an explanation of this. My wife, Rachel, can be startled easily. And there are times when I'm coming home where I will send a text message, hey, I'm coming home. I'll open the door. She's upstairs. It's me. I'm walking down the hallway, making noise as I'm walking. It's just me, babe. It's just me. Because there have been many times she's turned the corner and gone, and just jumped straight up. This is essentially what Jesus is doing. Like, hey, it's just me. Not a ghost. See? Real. Just me. Just me. Just, it's okay. It's okay. Don't be afraid. The things that are going around outside you, the things that are going on inside you, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. So which storm is it that is impeding your progress in your walk with Christ? There's two storms battering the disciples. One solution to quell each, to see Jesus for who he is, the sovereign God. For looking at the storm around me, I want you to think of Job 9:8. His power is greater than the storm. Job 9:8 says this. It's Job talking about God. And Job answered and said, truly I know that it is so, but how can a man be right before God? He continues to say, he's just describing God and who he is and who he alone is. Verse 8 says this, who alone stretched out the heavens and trampled the waves of the sea. Only God walks on the water. And when you see Jesus for who he is, when you see him as sovereign, the waves around me, the storm around me, those waves start looking a lot shorter. They're not nearly as frightening. They're not nearly as scary because God is so much greater and his power is so much higher than that of the storm around you. But what about the storm inside me? The storm inside me, his presence pacifies the storm. I want you to think about this. It's a weird thing. It says that he meant to pass them by. What was he expecting? Was he just like taunting them as a little insult to injury? Can you just imagine like the disciples like just desperately rowing and then all of a sudden they're just like, you're just like seeing Jesus pass them by. But that's what we imagine in our minds. That's not what's happening here. See, in the Old Testament, when God would pass by, he would be revealing his glory. We see it in Exodus, when God reveals his glory to Moses. We see it in 1 Kings 19, verse 11. This is Elijah. Once he has he's defeated the prophets of Baal, he's on the high point, and then all of a sudden, the Lord finally sends rain, and then Jezebel says, no, I'm going to kill you now. The evil queen comes after him, and so he runs and escapes into the mountains. He came to a cave and lodged in it, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts. For the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, throw down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. The storm around him is billowing. The storm inside him has left him feeling like he's not worth much. And he, God said, go out and stand before the mount of the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by. And a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in an earthquake. And after an earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. Jesus meaning to pass by. This is essentially, this is, in terms we use, Jesus is peacocking. He's on full display. Here's my glory. I need you to see me for who I am. I'm walking on the water. Only God does that. I'm passing by. Only God does that. But what do the disciples see? A ghost! All of Jesus' glory is on full display. And the disciples still can't see him for who he is. So God steps down to them. Despite their blindness, God steps down to them, enters into their boat. Says, I am clarity in your confusion. And when he got into the boat with them, the wind ceased. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves. For their hearts were hardened. It's both encouraging and a little bit crippling inside. Because I think a lot of us know, we've been talking about outreach and evangelism, we've got the card in the pocket, but I'm sure a lot of those names on there are people that you've been praying for already for years. People that may have been in your family, who have seen the full glory of God on display through the lives that you've lived. And yet they still don't see Jesus for who he is. And that's not easy. How could they have gotten to see everything of Jesus and still not see it? It's because they're caught in their own confusion. The disciples are the ones writing. They're saying, we didn't get it. Everything was clear to us. It was fully on display, and we couldn't see it to save our lives. Utterly astounded. You can just see Mark writing here, and the disciples talking, and just like, I don't know how we couldn't see it. Everything was right there. Take heart. The disciples' confusion is traded for clarity when they see Jesus for who he is. He's still rescuing. He's still saving. He's still going after. And your work and your efforts to love and to show those people the gospel is not in vain. He's still on the move. He's still moving in lives. God's not done yet. He's still revealing himself to disciples. He hasn't given up on them. He's still revealing himself to our world. He hasn't given up on you. But before we go on to the rest of what Jesus is doing in revealing himself and his glory on full display, I want to clear up a little confusion. So we're gonna take one little sidestep. So think of this as like an intermission, little pause in what we're talking about. Because this passage can be, at times, one that people who are particularly antagonistic toward Jesus and toward the Bible will say, like, there's a lot of discrepancies here. The one gospel says this, another gospel says that. And it couldn't be true. The whole Bible couldn't be true. And this is one of those passages that they choose to pick on. So we've already talked about physics and geometry. I'm not going to talk a whole lot about geography and geology. We're going to cut those out, and I'm going to simplify what we're going to talk about. So I'm going to kind of give you a couple little, like, tools to help you know that, like, you can trust God's word. So we're going to play a little game. Are you smarter than a fifth grader? And so I'm asking for full participation. If you think it's the first answer, answer A. I want you to raise your right hand. So we can just practice now. Raise your right hand for answer A. Fantastic. And if you think it's answer B, the second one, you can raise your left hand. Fantastic. We've got participation. It's time to play this game. Let's go. Question number one. How big is the Sea of Galilee? Is it about the size of Lake Michigan? We all know about how big that is. 118 miles wide, 307 miles long. Or is it way smaller than that, 8 miles wide, 13 miles long? Raise your right hand if you think it's answer A. Left hand for answer B. 3, 2, 1, show them. Oh, I hope you guys got that one. So I took two screenshots. This is off of my phone. These are about the same size. So you can see up in the top left corner of each image, there's a little legend that tells you about how big that is. Just so you can kind of get a grasp of this, the Sea of Galilee compared to where we are. See a little blue dot? That's us. Actually, that's probably at home when I was doing sermon prep, so just right over there. You can see the other side of the sea. It's not very big. If you're standing on one side of it, you can see across it. You might not be able to see down the lengthwise, but I'm going to show you guys in a little bit. The places that they're at, it's literally just the top little inlet. It's just and it's really only about 3 or 4 miles wide. It's not really big. It's small. You can see across it. So that will dispel some myths and rumors that you might hear. Question number two. What was common transportation in the region of Galilee in the first century? Was it A, Tesla Model 3, or was it B, walking and single-sail fishing vessels? Right hand for A, left hand for B. 3, 2, 1. Can't fool you guys. Can't fool you guys at all. Okay, so go ahead and throw up the next image. So this is, again, I used Apple Maps for the Apple people. This is now Google, Android. I don't know. Like, Apple is where I'm going, but I don't know. I tried to be a little ecumenical here. So on the left, that's taking roads that are currently there today from Capernaum to Bethsaida, 15 minutes. Now, mind you, what you're driving through is heavily contested owned land. And that's still only 15 minutes. And if you were to walk on the roads that are currently there, it'd take you about 3 hours. But if you're just to walk along the edge of the sea, so that's one of the things that people say, it's like, how could they have followed Jesus? They couldn't have seen him. Well, for one, it took them 3 or 4 hours to sail out to the middle, and it only would have taken you 2 to walk around it. And you can see across. I think we got this. All right, question number 3. You're on vacation on a beach in a tropical warm place, not here. A local is making small talk and asks you where you're from. What do you do? Do you A, take the next 20 minutes pulling out maps and math and explaining where Highland Park is, or B, reply, Chicago, make a lame joke about the snow and the traffic, then return to your bungalow and sip on your pineapple mango mint smoothie. A, B, 3, 2, 1, can't fool you guys. Okay, when you were describing where we live and about where we are, we use big cities as point markers to describe where that is. The Gospels are written by 4 different people to 4 different people groups. If I'm talking to a bunch of you and I'm talking about where the Chicago Botanic Gardens are, we're going to use some street names. If I'm in Florida, I'm going to say it's near Chicago, man. Like, it's the same thing. When the gospel writers are writing this, they're saying general direction to people not familiar with the area, and some of them are saying very specific locations to people who are intimately familiar with the area. Question number 4. What was the primary form of communication in the first century? Was it A, a complex 5G LTE network with abundant Wi-Fi hotspots for instantaneous texting, FaceTime, and location app services like Find My Messiah? Or was it B, face-to-face exchange of spoken words? Right hand A, left hand B, 3, 2, 1. You get it. You get it. So, go ahead and throw up the image of the next location. So, Capernaum is where they're sailing from. The miracle of feeding the 5,000 is near Bethsaida, and Jesus is telling the disciples to go toward Bethsaida, and they end up on the other side in Gennesaret. Why? Probably because the disciples were waiting for him in Bethsaida, and they're like, you know what, he didn't make it. We know we're going to the other side eventually. He'll meet us over there. Worst case, he'll walk it. He'll probably beat us. Little did they know, he's going to go straight line. So, when Jesus doesn't report in, option 2, we'll just meet him on the other side. Question number 5, should we keep playing this game? A, maybe, I'm not sure I'm smarter than a 5th grader. B, nope, point made, move on, I want to fill in the next blank on my notes. You get the point. So, I play this little game with you because I want you to know that there are very reasonable, even to a 5th grader, explanations for why there are differences or even perceived differences in the Gospels. It's very easy to make these arguments, these counterpoints. So when confusion is weaponized with apparent conflict, when you come across someone who's saying, you're so stupid to believe this. I don't know how you could be so confused to think this. When confusion is weaponized with apparent conflict, the antidote is found in clarity from God's word. You can find it, I promise you. And if you can't find it, we have someone with their PhD in New Testament studies. I guarantee that he can help you out. I'm his little lackey. I can probably help as well. It's there. It's clear. You can believe it. This is something that you can hold on to. There is clarity when you think that there is confusion. So let's continue on. Verse 53. And when they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret, moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick on their beds to wherever he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in marketplaces and implored him that they might even touch the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. Point number 3, I am hope for your healing. What's the point? What's the point of this? As we're reading through all of this dialogue in Mark, point is, we're supposed to see Jesus for who he is. He is God. The disciples are wrongly astounded because they can't comprehend what's going on, because they can't see Jesus for who he is. But believers, those of us who have trusted Jesus Christ, we're supposed to see him for who he is. We should be astounded at his works of his kindness and the miracles that he's working constantly in our midst. Just a couple weeks ago, we saw Steve Brown, who came up and just told us a little bit about his job search. Many of you know what John Kilner has been going through, as the cancer has just been receding throughout his body as an act of God. It does not have an explanation. But when was the last time that we were astounded by something that Jesus did? Or is it just an expectation that he's going to do this? I don't want you to be astounded because you don't understand or you're confused. I want you to be astounded and amazed at what he's doing because of his goodness and his kindness. That God himself would step down and engage with us, even when we're blindly myopic and short-sighted to who he is. We're supposed to see Jesus for who he is. There's no limit to his power. And this isn't necessarily the focus, but I can't help but see this throughout the sixth chapter of Mark, it starts in Nazareth where no great works could be done because the people didn't believe. Then he sends out the disciples and they themselves work miracles. And there's this incredible movement. And just a few verses later, the disciples are in the boat going, I don't know how he's doing this. This doesn't make sense. You just did it yourselves. How can you flip-flop? Be encouraged, because guess what? You and I do the same flip-flopping every single day. So Nazareth, he can't do great works. The disciples go out into the other cities. They do great works. The disciples are in their boat. How in the world can this be happening? And then they go into the cities and they bring people to him because they believe that if they can just touch the tassels on his garment, that they would be healed. No belief, yes belief, no belief, yes belief. And when we see Jesus for who he is, things change. Miracles happen. But maybe that's not you. Maybe you're like, I've seen it for others. I know it. I can intellectually make the ascent to understand that Jesus works miracles, but he's not working them for me. And maybe you're someone who you're just like, I know within the last year that God has not answered the prayers that I have. I've lost someone I've loved. The thing that I was hoping for didn't happen. Friend, this isn't the place. Our time here on this earth is not God's greatest miracle. His greatest miracle has already been worked. He has ripped open the doors. He has opened the opportunity for us to come to him and find freedom and salvation. Our sin had chained us down, and there was no hope for us in the entire world. But God opened it. And his greatest work is the opportunity to have eternal salvation in him. If you don't think that he's answered your prayer, I want you to think about Revelation 21, where it says this, Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more, that chaotic thing. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He is dwelling with them. There's power in his presence. New Jerusalem is coming, but his spirit is living in us now. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, Behold, I am making all things new. He also said, Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Friend, we're supposed to see Jesus for who he is. Your healing has already happened. It will continue to happen, and it will complete in eternity. Do not be short-sighted in your vision of who Jesus is. We can't have this myopic approach to Jesus. He is God, all sovereign, all powerful. His presence is with every believer through the Spirit. Don't look past him. Look to him, because he is saving today and yesterday and forevermore. And I want to just take a moment and pray with you right now. And I want you to just close your eyes. I'm not going to have you raise your hands. I'm not going to have you come forward. If you're the person who says, for me, I need to see God is sovereign in the storm because everything is up and around me and nothing is the way that it was supposed to be, and I can't see Jesus for who he is because I'm having a hard time just looking at these waves. Or shoot, I can't even see him for who he is. I think he's a ghost because everything inside me is scrambled, it's mixed up. For you, Lord, would you help them to see you for who you are? You trample on the waves of the sea. You pass by to show us your glory because when we see you for who you are, the waves are so small in comparison to who you are. The sea has no power in comparison to your Son, Jesus Christ. If it's confusion in your own heart or confusion in the life of someone you know, Lord, we know that you bring clarity. Your word is so powerful and clear, and sometimes it is difficult to see, even when we've seen all that you've done. So, Lord, I just ask for eyes unveiled, that the confusion would give way to clarity, and that by rightly seeing who you are, they might move forward. Maybe it's for healing. You've just been hoping beyond hope that the Lord would show up. And he just hasn't. And you're wondering why. And that hope is waning thin. Lord, right now I just ask that you would show yourself to be the God who heals. You're the great physician. Hope is what we hold on to. Lord, we know that someday soon you are coming again and there will be no more sickness and no more pain. That healing will be in its totality. But Lord, we're asking in hope, knowing who you are, that even when the disciples disbelieved, you stepped into the boat with them because you love them and you love us now. Lord, would you show yourself to be the healer that you are?